I love the bridge. I love the bridge.
Very weird.
Melt into us and become part of us.
Oh no.
Play this out. Hello and welcome to another episode of Me, My Dad and Music. I'm me, I'm Brew. This is my dad.
Hi.
He's Bruce. And today we're going to be talking about solo albums. But today it's not just me, my dad and music. It's me, my dad and my mate Nick Munnery as well, who we're going to say hello to here. You might recognise him if you've watched my Tomb Raider Race to the End show. So we're going to let him in the meeting room and say hello.
Hello.
Hey, how you doing?
Good, thank you. Yeah, how are you?
Very good. Yeah, this week we're talking about our favourite solo records. So we're going to talk about what qualifies as a solo album and what makes a great solo album. So first up, I wanted to ask you guys, because each of us has picked a solo record where it's just the artist's name is the artist's name. So does it matter within a solo record if they use their real name or if they were to use an alias like City in Colour or even something that's more approaching a band name like Dashboard Confessional? What do you guys think of that?
Well, for me, I don't know if I can think of any solo artist who's used a band name. I would see it, for me, I'd see it like I would for someone who's writing and they're using a pseudonym, if they're using a different name. I mean, it doesn't mean anything significant. I don't mind whether it's the person's name, some pseudonym or something else, providing it is, if it's a band name, right, you'd want to know that it was, you know, definitely their material or they're the dominant musicality or and indeed maybe producer or something like that.
If it's one person doing the writing and the main performer, I think that's probably what would be solo. Potentially my selection today may be slightly different, because one reading into it which I didn't follow was, is a solo artist someone that's kind of come out of a band? Because that's quite common as well, isn't it, where someone leaves and has a solo career, whereas my selection wasn't in a at least famous band.
Does it matter how much of the music that they played themselves on the record? Does the approach matter? Does it matter if it's a collaborative or if it's more prescriptive approach, if they do have other players on the record? Is it better if they've played literally everything on the record? Is it just as good if they play everything apart from percussion?
I would say that the artists themselves, to be a solo artist, doesn't need to do that. They're most likely going to be the singer. And if they can support that with a guitar, they probably will. But I don't think it's necessary. And there's people, for example, Phil Collins, who's made solo career playing drums, as you know, famous for playing the drums as well. So I'd say it will be hard pushed. I can't think of an example where someone doesn't sing on their solo album. That would be potentially a definition.
If the album's under their name, then that's enough for me. I mean, I'm trying to think around. It's quite an interesting question you're raising. I'm thinking Nick Mason. I've got a solo album by Nick Mason, so from Pink Floyd. And I mean, he does Nick Mason on it, but I don't think he's the main singer. He might have done some singing on it. I don't really remember him. I just remember he just drew in loads of great artists and instrumentalists and produced a pretty good album.
that works for the pop music as well, where it's in someone's name, but they haven't written the song. So they're performing it, but it's not their song. So I guess the summary would be then, if it's in their name, then it's their album.
I like it.
Or their pseudo-name.
Yeah, you don't need to be Mike Oldfield to be a solo artist, you know, playing every instrument and writing everything and producing everything and on your own in the studio almost.
So now we've got that out of the way, what is it for you guys that makes a great solo record? For me, when I'm thinking of like a traditional solo record, I think of something where often it's stripped back. It might be centered around just an individual and an acoustic. And then I also think of your more out there experimental solo records. So like somebody's gone solo from a band to then pursue something a bit more left field.
So I think for me, like how I kind of also judged mine was, first of all, to be a great record, every track should be strong. Perhaps obviously you can have a slightly weaker one or two. And to reflect that artist as well. So to make it great, it's got to kind of be their, potentially their defining achievement. That could vary from person to person. The listener could have different interpretation of that. But for your great album, it will be the one that really speaks that artist to you.
Yeah, and I don't think I could, I'd state any particular criteria because music is so broad. For me, I think it's whether the album's great or not, you know, and whether when I was thinking through it, I was thinking, this is a great artist. Have they produced a great solo album? You know, the great solo artist is, have they got a really good album? Quite often, it was really hard to distinguish between one album and another because they might have two or three really good albums.
All right, so let's do some honourable mentions then, because we can't pick everything and there's a lot of good solo albums out there. So I'd just like to invite you guys, if you've got one or two maybe solo records that didn't quite make the cut but you'd like to put a little spotlight on now.
Nick, would you like to go first?
Sure, yeah. So there is quite a modern singer-songwriter, but I think his music does kind of stand out. It took a little while for me to get into, but Ben Howard, Every Kingdom, that album is very strong, very chilled out, easy to listen to. Frank Turner, I'm sure, Brew, you'll be familiar with Million Dead, but he's got several very good albums. Poetry of the Deed is my favourite of that. Quite rocked up, and that's an example of someone who plays with a band. I think they're a fairly consistent band, but they will be session musicians.
Yeah, so they're called Frank Turner and the Sleeping Souls, isn't it?
That's the one.
But they were actually in a band called Dive Dive before that, the band members.
And then I've got two where they do use a pseudonym. So Tallest Man on Earth, love, his voice is very strange at first, but if you give it a listen, it does grow on you. And his The Wild Hunt album is my favourite. And the final one is Get Kate Where Kate Fly. Quite modern, again, down that kind of rock line, almost could be a band. And I think they're one that definitely get mistaken for a band, but he is a solo artist. So the Chronicles of a Bohemian Teenager, that album is definitely worth a listen as well.
That's a good title.
So there's two for me that didn't quite make it, but I think are brilliant. The first one being A Mark Omission, A Brand of Scar by Dashboard Confessional. Dashboard Confessional is this one guy, I think he's called Chris Carabera or something like that. And this particular record, I mean, it has the direct and vulnerable raw emotion that he displayed on the previous record, The Places You've Come to Fear the Most. But now he's actually supported with like a full band and it sounds really tight and clear, without getting in the way of any of his songwriting or just the rawness of how emotional this dude is. And Tim Cash's Monogamy. This is a record that sounds like an epic film score, but like for a failed marriage or a failing marriage. And it's really smart. The way it's told from shifting narrative perspectives with like cutting lyricism, it's awesome. The album provides like a social commentary on the concept of monogamy.
Well, it's very interesting from my point of view to hear you might have noticed my eyes dropped down there as I was jotting down what you guys were saying, because most of the stuff that you're talking about, I haven't heard of the names. And also I can understand where Brew's original question came from about, you know, can they have a different name or whatever, or have a band name? Because that really wasn't, you know, that really wasn't what was happening in my time. So I've got a few albums here, and I've even kind of brought them along. So here we go. Hey, who's that, guys? Blonde on Blonde. It was between that and Highway 61 Revisited. What an artist, and obviously, you know, a man who can write words. Here's another one, John Martin. So John Martin is like a kind of came from folk rock, but it's kind of drifty, dreasy kind of. It's called One World. It's great art cover there. That's definitely a kind of, that's a surprise entry in there. And here we go, Rick Wakeman. From Yes, Six Wives of Henry VIII. What a great idea. Take some history, six wives, have six tracks, put them on, and get the characters of the wives into each track. Not that I knew enough about history to be able to understand that when I first heard it. And, you know, how can you not have David Bowie in there? I need to guess the price of that CD. And for me, this was between Hunky Dory and Aladdin Sane, both of whom have... great pianists, Rick Wakeman being the one on this one. Aladdin Sane, the pianist, is fantastic. But Hunky Dory just makes it for me such a beautiful album, and great tracks in it. And Bowie is an artist who could transform himself from album to album, which is quite an achievement.
Okay, so those were our honourable mentions. And next we're going to talk about each of our selections for our favourite solo album of all time in turn. So I'm going to go first, and my pick is James Iha, and the album is titled Let It Come Down. So James Iha is most famous for being a member of the Smashing Pumpkins. He was in the band from their inception, played on their early demos, Nothing Ever Changes, self-titled, and the Moon demo, and he played with them up until they broke up in 2000 after leaking Machina 2, which was the record that Virgin Records wouldn't put out. And then he's recently, in 2018, returned to the band for touring and the recording of Shiny and Oh So Bright, Volume 1, No Past, No Future, No Sun. He's been a member of A Perfect Circle, Vanessa and the O's, and the short-lived Tinted Windows, which had members of Cheap Trick and Hanson in it. It was a very sort of pop sort of band. But he's also done a handful of guest appearances on other people's records, contributing guitar, vocals, remixes. And he also owned an indie label himself and a studio. So his role in Smashing Pumpkins, he was always like the quiet, stylish, cool and mysterious one.
I liked your description of what he was like as a character within a member of the band. It seemed to, for every word that you put out there, really fitted what I think I was experiencing on the album.
Yeah. Oh wow! Okay, so that came through on record as well.
Yeah. Well, and the pictures as well. Playing on YouTube, each different track they'd have a different picture. Maybe the album cover. A cool looking guy.
Definitely a handsome guy as well. His love of country, I think, was first shown in how he would sort of dress on stage, and then with this solo record, and then later on he was. He joined the alt country band Whiskey Town for an album. I'm going to be particularly interested in what you think of the album, Dad, because I know you said previously...
On the whole, I don't like country music.
...that you weren't much into country, and I know there's tinges of that on this record. But he's never been a prolific songwriter. There were 14 years between his solo albums, Let It Come Down and Look to the Sky. This is the first one he'd done. He actually negotiated his solo album deal whilst they were cutting demos in Sadlands for Melancholy and Infinite Sadness.
Wow, long time ago. Haven't heard him sing that much. Big fan of the Pumpkins, but he doesn't really take centre stage on many of their tracks.
He co-wrote I Am One on the debut record and two of the best songs on Siamese Dream. But he barely played on the first three records.
Maybe Billy was forcing that a little bit within the band.
Control freak?
Yeah.
Some people have said. Maybe just a perfectionist. He recently did a reflection and a track-by-track guide to Gish, which is their opening record, their debut record, one of the best-selling, or the best-selling indie record at the time. Breaking world records. He said that when it came to it, when the recording light went on, the other guys just couldn't play to that standard. So it was left to him to pull it out. And Butch Vig, who produced those first couple of records, wasn't too impressed with the playing of Darcy and James. So.
So you mentioned that it's got the country kind of sound. I got a pop vibe from this record. I found them very catchy. First of all, I suppose I should say that I love Pumpkins, and I've never really spent time listening to the solo albums by any of the members. I potentially have given this a cursory listen a long time ago. Definitely Billy's album, but only once or twice. So I was quite actually interested to spend some time and actually really focus on the music. I was surprised how different it was to the Smashing Pumpkins.
Thought that little build there was going to lead to a heavier moment. It's very easy listening.
Could hear some slight bits of grunge in the voice. I don't know if there was some reverb put onto his voice to bring that out.
It's quite poppy. I can hear a little bit of the grunge sound in his voice, especially when he holds a note for a while.
So I had I've got no Smashing Pumpkins background, and so it's kind of coming in fresh for James here.
He's got a kindly melodic voice, a bit like the Beatles now. He evokes lovely images with his lyrics.
And the words that I kind of wrote down that I felt I was hearing across the album were fragile, kindly, melodic, gentle and thoughtful, and summery, as in the summer.
Definitely summery. Had a heat wave this week, and I did definitely feel it was a good soundtrack to have on while the weather was so good.
Yeah. Feels like quite a summery track.
I texted words to this effect to you, Dad, didn't I? Saying, "Oh, this is the perfect record for this sort of heat this time." So there is this infamous Billy Corgan interview where he talks about James negotiating his contract for a solo album deal, contributing towards the end of the band Smashing Pumpkins, with it not being James's sole focus around the release of Adore. This album came out the same year as Adore. Billy was sort of, he described himself as disappointed in James, but maybe it came across a bit bitter that he didn't seek out any help from him on Let It Come Down. So there's a few lines where Billy would have said, "You can do a better lyric there, or you can do a better take and stuff." But, you know, people in the comments of this interview say this is probably exactly why he wanted to do it all by himself.
If he's come out with an album that you, Brew, rate as being your favourite solo album, then, you know, that's an achievement, and he did it off his own bat, really.
Yeah. For me personally, it stood out and it felt special whenever he sung the lead vocal on Wax. There were the final tracks on Dawn to Dusk and Twilight to Starlight, and there was one song on Pisces Iscariot, which is like a B-sides compilation album that filled the gap between Siamese Dream and Melancholy. And all of these tracks, they just had this dreamy quality. But it was actually a track called Believe, which just enchanted me, and that made me seek out this solo record. Believe, I believe, captures everything that I like about James's style. It's this hopeful, angelic, with beautiful strings and gently plucked guitar. Yet at the same time, it's kind of wistful with this soft vocal style, and it has this sad undertone and like a mournful slide guitar sort of thing as well. And I first heard it on this, on the partner album of Pisces, Judas O, which is actually a B-sides compilation released with some versions of the posthumous Best of Rotten Apples. But it was first actually released as a B-side to the single 1979, which I have. I have it on the Aeroplane Flies High box set. And 1979 it's arguably their most famous song. So that's where this song Believe was first to be found. And what I loved in Believe, I found more of in the Aeroplane Flies High box set and in the solo album Let It Come Down. And for me, it was like a journey of discovery. I had to seek out these songs, and it was really rewarding once I found them. I know that this is like one of the most placid albums you might ever hear, and it's stuffed full of lyrics about love, and sometimes it's sung flat, which it'd be interesting to hear your take on that, Dad, because I know you're not too keen on another love song sort of thing. But and normally I would hate that too.
Not just all about love or whatever, but really interesting stuff as well.
Oh, it's lovely. It's about holding and caring and encouraging. I love the guitar. Very melodic, nicely arranged with the instruments. Lovely. First impression, very good.
But somehow this record like disarms me and it charms me. It's bright and heavenly. Lots of gently picked guitar.
Well described.
Bottlenecks, like guitar slides, luscious builds of strings. It's gorgeous.
Nice bit of strings.
Gentle acoustic guitar intro. Bit of light bit of drums. Nice voice.
Like beautiful guitar.
The tune matching the lyrics. All the different instruments gently fading in and out. It's a good song.
I jotted it down, see if I can pick them up again, but I heard what I thought were influences or sounds like through some of the tracks. So I heard Jackson Browne, who you may not know. I brought a Jackson Browne album cover here for you to see. Late for the Sky. Jackson Browne was probably the closest in terms of general feel for me. I heard like Tom Petty type singing, which was interesting. And Winter, which was my favorite track, to me spoke of shades of George Harrison vocals, kind of like late or post-Beatles George Harrison.
I love the strings and the vocal range he displays on Winter, and the it's just blissful conclusion to that song.
I thought that there was parts of the songs that I particularly enjoyed.
Nice little change there. Why does it have to be this way? That's a nice little bridge section.
I perhaps need a few more listens to really appreciate it as a full album. Distinguishing between the songs was slightly difficult for me. This album, for me, it was moments within songs that stood out. Quite liked being surprised by those moments.
In my notes, I've got loads of, I love the bridge, I love the bridge. It's like, it's not the biggest part of the song, but he seems to write really good bridges. And it's those second guitar parts that I love on Pumpkins records that you can hear more on this record. Like, he has these sort of country twangs all over the place.
In the last track, in fact, I didn't know whether it was an additional track or something. It was called My Advice. Is that part of the album, or is it
that's
not?
That's a bonus track.
Ah, right. Well, what I liked about My Advice was the end. So what you were saying there, Nick, about the parts of it, the ending after 2:50 was, I listened to that, I thought, this is really good. Then I thought to myself, what does that sound like? And I spent a long time in my slow acting brain trying to work it out. And I think it reminded me of a kind of change that went on in an ELO track, Electric Light Orchestra. It was lovely to hear that and to be reminded of that.
Hmm. My second essential pick was Beauty. I'm really intrigued to hear what you thought of this, Dad, because it's got the lyrics. It goes, love, love, love. Love is what you need. And normally I'd balk at those sort of cheesy lyrics and throw them out. But something pure and innocent about everything, like James says, that just charms me.
Yeah, it's not too teenagery or frothy or kind of meaningless or just repeating the word love. His lyrics, which I don't know whether I presume he writes them, were pretty good, and I liked that.
Nice gentle acoustic intro again. That reminds me of the Mamas and Papas. Well, like Be Strong Now, it's beautifully produced.
And I liked the fact it was upbeat. Again, it had that summer feel to it. Because I think the context of the whole album is there's a lot of kind of love type songs in it. They weren't the cheap ones. They were rather special. And those words that you've been using to describe it, Brew, were very accurate, I think, in relation to it. And Nick, what you were saying about you've only kind of really heard it for maybe a couple of times, that you're kind of singing from the same song sheet as Brew and I on that. We like to have things that take a bit longer to melt into us and become part of us.
Yeah, and it's not often that you actually do it. I made myself find time to listen to two albums that I just wouldn't have listened to previously. I've had a chance to listen to particularly your pick, Brew, of James Iha, because I did like Bumpkins, and I've just never taken the time to sit down and enjoy it. So, yeah, that was great. With this song, there was quite a lot of offbeat accents, kind of like bunka, 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 kind of that kind of feel. And that to me is not get up and dance, but it puts a bit of rhythm into it. And I thought this track was that was very good.
That's the drummer in you speaking there, isn't it? So that was discussion on James Iha's Let It Come Down, his debut solo record. Next up, I'm going to pass it over to my dad, Bruce.
Cool.
So my choice of my favourite solo album, which took a lot of thinking, is an artist called Brian Eno, and the album is called Here Come the Warm Jets, which I believe was his first solo album. I have a number of his albums. That's the great cover, I think. And on the back, with the normal kind of listings of tracks, is a picture of Brian himself. So Brian came from, and we were discussing earlier about where the solo artists come from. Brian in particular comes from Roxy Music, well, in terms of famous bands. And Roxy Music was, for me, the best glam rock type band. They had great, great tracks. They had Brian Ferry as a lead singer and a real kind of glamorous character. And they had, to begin with, Brian Eno in the background as well, and a splendid guitarist called Phil Manzanera. Now, Brian Eno, I think, fell out a little bit with Brian Ferry and pulled out and came into a solo career fairly early on. So he was only around for early Roxy Music. And Roxy Music themselves went on, I wouldn't say from strength to strength, but they went on and did some great albums. They were great of their genre, and then kind of became slightly more sophisticated as they went on and mellowed a bit. And they were very good at that too. So I've got a Roxy Music compilation album, which is great. It just kind of goes through from the beginning to the end of their favorite tracks, and it's very good. So Roxy Music themselves, although they changed when Brian Eno left, they continued. So does that mean that Brian Eno wasn't much of a contributor? Well, it probably doesn't mean that at all, because when you come across this particular album, it just packs a punch. It's so different. Every track is different. It's so creative. So I was kind of writing down some of the descriptions that I saw and my own thoughts about descriptions of the type of music. And we came across things like glammed up pop art, glam rock, crunchy rock guitar, art pop. That's quite good, I think, art pop. Avant-garde, I think it's highly experimental, and each track is creatively different. And I think it played off a bit from the falling out with him and Brian Ferry, but mainly because he is such a creative musician. So he brings into this album all sorts of people. So I've just written down where they've come from. Robert Fripp, very famous. John Wetton from King Crimson. Chris Spedding, who was kind of more of either a kind of slight solo, but would be playing with, on demand. Somebody from Hawkwind. Paul Rudolph from the Pink Fairies. Now, I hadn't heard any Pink Fairies until I started doing this research. And Bill McCormack from Matching Mole, who we will probably hear about later on in another session. And all of the team from Roxy Music, apart from Brian Ferry. He selected them, I think, to be musically incompatible, just to see what could come out. On the lyrics, this is quite interesting. If you did manage to spend some time listening to the music and the lyrics, they're nonsensical. So I think the approach that he took was, here's the music, what words, what sounds, what words can I draw from the sounds of the music? Then he took those words and tried to construct some kind of semi-meaningful sentences or phrases, and then just kind of tag them all together to go with the flow of the music. So some of it's kind of nonsense. Some of it's a bit grim, but there's no particular meaning in it. The album itself, I think, probably, I don't know if it did particularly well to begin with, but because he has become such a kind of tower himself, I think it is of great interest. And for me, I just love the album from when I first heard it. Again, I had this dilemma of which of two albums. There was another one called Another Green World, and I just couldn't make up my mind which one to choose. Another Green World speaks more of where he goes to in the future, but he just did so well with this starting solo album that I think it just pipped it for me, but only just. So, Eno, and perhaps you're probably more familiar with David Bowie. So David Bowie reinvents himself, as we mentioned before, reinvents himself each album on each album because he's such a creative guy. He brings in great musicians and directs them, as I think, as to how he wants things, but works collaboratively as well. David Bowie is outstanding. I would like to suggest that Brian Eno actually has a greater scope than David Bowie. Eno stretches across a broader musical landscape. So he's got glam, art, experimental and avant-garde, which we mentioned before. I think he might. He was certainly around at the beginning of ambient music, and he might have been actually the father of ambient music, I'm not sure. But I just remember ambient music. I bought a couple of ambient music albums and thought, well, these are so different. He's a producer. He's produced Talking Heads, Devo, Paul Simon, Grace Jones. He's produced for Microsoft, believe it or not, Microsoft Windows. U2, Ultravox, Coldplay, and the kind of list of albums that I saw, 115 albums that were either his or that he's been involved with. He's done film music. Now, he did the film Dune, and I know he's done other films because sometimes I watch a film and I listen to the music, I think that sounds a bit like Brian Eno, and it turns out to be Brian Eno when you look at the credits at the end. But if you search for Brian Eno film music, unfortunately, he's actually got an album called Music for Films, so you can't get beyond that without knowing
how more music for films as well.
I would love to follow up on those. I think he's done music for apps and computer games as well. He's been all over the place in terms of using his musical skills.
It sounds like he also then not only reinvents himself for the albums, it's like he's reinventing himself for his career path as well, diversifying from just being a musician to applying to more than just music.
Yes, in fact, I wouldn't use, although I think that description you use there works for David Bowie, he doesn't reinvent, he just has a natural flow on progressing from one thing to another and making the most of each element. And the people love collaborating. Actually, he did collaborate with David Bowie, of course. He collaborated on Heroes and Low, possibly another, it might have been Lodger. And Heroes is a really good album, Low is pretty good. And is a very heavy contributor to those albums.
I liked how you pulled out the his lyrical wordplay. It goes for sounds rather than sense. That was something I noticed first listen.
Bizarre vocals. Can't really get into the lyrics first time with most things, including this, but it sounds like Brian Eno's got some thought-provoking lyrics going on, and some strange ones too.
You said some of the stuff was a bit grim. I noted that some of them are old. Sounded like it should be played in a funeral. It's got that organ and the remember me refrain.
I didn't know much about Eno, so I did look up because I was interested to know, the man behind the music. And I read something that he used to dream a lot of the lyrics and write them down when he woke up, just put them in his songs. I think there was one particular one that they quote for that, which is On Some Faraway Beach, which was actually one of the tracks that I think stood out for me. It's maybe one of the more normal ones, actually, even if they were dreamed up. I guess that's quite nice because you can read whatever you want into them as well, which opens them up to more a wider audience as well, perhaps.
And so I picked a couple of essential tracks for you guys to listen to. One was Blank Frank and the other is Dead Finks Don't Talk. So let's start with Blank Frank and tell me how that hit you.
Instead of having like a solid steady drum beat, he's got like sort of three different layers of percussion going on. Gives it a sort of cluttered feel.
Yeah, lots going on, lots to listen to.
That lead, that distortion on it. then going back into the groove of what the rest of the instruments are doing. Nice.
This one was deliberately, I think, placed in the album to disrupt you. It comes in with bang, bang, like it interjects almost, it disrupts the flow.
There's definitely lots of interesting effects put on the guitar. It sounds almost off tune in bits. It works, but it just has a kind of off tune sound.
How I kind of summed up my listening of the album was, first time particularly, very weird. And I think this song almost typifies the album for me, where it is quite, no, I guess it was a bit jarring, that song, but just all the oddities that he's put into his music, I think came across in this song.
Blank Frank is the messenger of your doom and your destruction is how it starts, and the musicality behind it is just like that.
I think I'm definitely gonna want to listen back to this for the lyrics, to hear them a bit more carefully.
I think this is just sort of like a really long, messy outro I'm getting now. Yeah, nice fade on the instruments, panning into the centre.
So the other track was Dead Finks Don't Talk. That is actually my favourite track on this, what I think is a stunning album. What did you guys make of that one?
Nice drum beat start, nice groove coming in.
Quite catchy.
Spoken word, not really singing, but that sort of brings more attention to the lyrics.
Definitely interesting vocals.
Very low oohs and ahs in the background as the second verse comes in, spoken again.
Quite a lot of parts to the song, different bits to listen to. The drums seem to keep the same throughout.
Even more backing in the, what I presume is going to be the final chorus. It's adding extra layers as it goes along. Rhythmic laughing with a guitar solo into that. Sounds sort of robotic almost.
Interesting guitar sound in the solo.
Heavy guitar solo, very distorted. I'm enjoying the cover art as well. It's like a photograph with like a whole bunch of stuff, sort of collage almost. It uses panning and different sort of vocal styles to press home certain lyrics, I think. Shown again by this spoken word bit with some low backing vocals. Sounds like it's in a big, whole, booming sort of voice. Then a chorus or a choral backing part.
It's also my favourite track of the album. That would definitely be one of my essential tracks.
Funnily enough, yeah, I thought this was my favourite song of the album as well. I mean, I obviously talked about On Some Faraway Beach, but this one got what the album was. I really enjoyed it, and I'm pleased that I found it. And I think I've jotted down Another Green World to check out more of his works. Yeah.
I like how with this track, the end just rips away, and it has this just such a weird outro that just forces you to pay attention to it.
That was unexpected. Oh, that's dirty.
Interesting outro. Quite prog rock. 70s prog rock.
Robotic. Oh, that's a nasty end. I love that. Wow. Dead Things Don't Talk. Rate that.
The tracks on this album, once they kind of, because they cut into your brain in a sense, then they become hooked into your brain. And I became very familiar with the album, you know what track is following on next. And there's an anticipation for each track. That you want to go for the segues and things, and you want it to go on to the next track. You've got that one move when it moves into from On Some Faraway Beach into Blank Frank. You go, nice, and then Blank Frank is the messenger of your doom instruction. And then I know when I come to the end of Blank Frank, which is quite a visceral song, then I'm going to go into Dead Things Don't Talk. And in my mind, I'm anticipating everything that's in there. And that's the one where the vocals are very interesting over across the span of the whole album.
Not a terrific singer, but it definitely takes you somewhere.
You've got he's got some very nasal vocals. He's got some kind of choiry type vocals. The vocals are there almost like an instrument, and particularly in Blank Frank, where he goes, oh no, oh no, oh no, oh no. And then there's plenty of stuff going on around it. It's not just that, but he makes it work in there, and drives that particular song forward as well. And then when you're familiar with that, and you know it comes back later on in the track, you think, oh, come on, really, get that bit back in again.
I think, yeah, it's definitely worth talking about that in a moment. Yeah, the first time I heard that, I did laugh.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
I like the back in on the second chorus here. There's like a, oh, Lord, oh, Lord. Sounds like a chicken. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord, oh, Lord.
But now it works so well in the song, and it's the thing that's in my head now all the time. I'm imagining, you know, if I drop a plate or something, I'm just going to be going, oh no.
Oh no, oh no, oh no.
And it's worth thinking, if you take it back to the context at the time, it's a very brave album. Mm. It's very brave. I mean, the cover itself is kind of brave. And there's a song on there called Babies on Fire, which is grim. And you just want to, oh, no, no. And then the words go through. But it's a fantastic piece of music. It's a very brave thing because he's doing these experimental things. He's experimenting with words. He's experimenting with the musicians. He's experimenting with the vocals. But he's clearly, he's got ideas to begin with. And he's very gifted at taking all of those things and hearing them and knowing how to put them together. The braveness, the expression of artistry involved was probably, you know, a good grounding for the next albums that came through. And then his broadening of scope into the musical business, where he is somebody that many artists would come to for creative ideas. The other thing that you can, if you wanted to, look up about for Brian Eno is something called Oblique Strategies. Just type in Brian Eno Oblique Strategies, and there it's a technique for being and maintaining your creativity.
I noted that I thought he distorted like tracks. So like through his production techniques, it was a bit like listening to a song in the same way you would like recall an obscured memory. And that's a very brave thing to do when you've got these all these amazing musicians featured and playing on your record, but you're going to go and mess around with how it sounds and distort it in various unique and trailblazing ways.
That might link in with if he's recalling how he has heard things in his dreams, perhaps, you know.
Yeah. I think the other standout track for me was Driving Me Backwards, because that's really effective in unsettling you. And it has like a crazy, really kooky sort of vocal style as well.
It's got a driving rhythm, hasn't it? It's like a factory thumping.
Yeah.
I think the first time that I really heard something different in the first track was when the music drops out kind of two-thirds in towards the end. And I appreciated that. But it was definitely the first time where I was like, this isn't going to be a normal album.
I've got to give you props as well, Dad. You've picked the heaviest album out of all of us here.
Oh, who yes.
Who would have guessed that?
Okay, so my pick was Nick Drake. It's not really a secret that he's quite underappreciated in life. He did suffer from depression and unfortunately did die quite young. He overdosed on some medication, only 26. And I think a lot of people kind of think this is reflected in his music, but there's a lot of people who were close to him at the time who said that this isn't the case. And I think that comes out musically once you know a little bit more about him. So I think the background is quite interesting for reflecting on his music. So perhaps we'll come back to that when we're talking about the album that I've picked. Because of this though, and he's musically was releasing music in the kind of mid-late 60s, I wasn't around to hear it firsthand at the time. So I actually discovered the album through a book, Nick Hornby. He's got a book called A Long Way Down, and it's based around a group of misfits, almost. Misfits is maybe a bit unfair, eclectic mix of people is a bit more accurate. And they meet on a New Year's Eve on top of a building where they've got suicidal thoughts. So you can kind of see how it links in with the music and why Nick Hornby perhaps picked Nick Drake for this next section. So the group, as I said, they're quite eclectic and there's certain frictions between them. The storyline, this isn't spoilers, but they come down off the roof and they agree to be each other's support network. And it's the relationship between these people that the book is based on. But I thought perhaps I'd just read a small quote from the book describing a moment where they almost, they're arguing and then they bond over a Nick Drake record. So one of them, I believe, is a musician in the book, and he puts on the record and he says, "I thought I couldn't go wrong with Nick Drake, especially in a room full of people who've got the blues. If you haven't heard him, man, it's like he boiled down all the melancholy in the world, all the bruises and all the effed up dreams you've let go, and poured those essences into a little tiny bottle and corked it up. And when he starts to play and sing, he takes the cork out and you can smell it. You're pinned into your seat as if it's a wall of noise, but it's not. It's still and it's quiet, and you don't want to breathe in case you frighten it away." And I guess I was kind of a teenager when I heard that, and it kind of resonated a little bit, and I couldn't not check out Nick Drake after I heard that.
Where did you start with Nick Drake?
Yeah, so the album they listen to in that book is Five Leaves Left, and to be honest, I'm still quite unfamiliar with that album. I am much more familiar with Brighter Later, which I think it's Five Leaves Left, I believe, is his first, followed with Brighter Later, and lastly Pink Moon. And my favourite track, and perhaps that's why I'm drawn to Brighter Later, is Northern Sky. It's actually, I think people pretty much generally agree, it's his only real love song. We were talking earlier about how perhaps solo artists, and particularly people like Nick Drake, where it's singer-songwriter, tend to write a lot about love. One of the reasons I love the album I've picked is because the lyrics are about much more than that. They're deeper, and you know, you can take more than just he likes someone, do they like him? So the album that I've picked is Pink Moon. As I mentioned earlier, he was quite underappreciated at the time. Looking it up for this, I was surprised to find out that it only sold 5,000 records in North America until 1999, 25 years after he passed away. So why is he so famous now? He was actually featured in a Volkswagen commercial. It's a very slightly American dream, cruising at night in the car, big moon in the sky, very pretty. And that kind of got people into Nick Drake, and his album in the following year sold about 70,000 copies. And it just snowballed from there. Great that that happened, because now he's become a very familiar name in music. A song on that advert was Pink Moon, the title track of my pick, Pink Moon. And I'll be very interested to hear your reflections on that. We start with Brew.
Well, first up, I'd say I sort of dismissed Nick Drake as boring music my dad listens to. But you often spoke of him. So it was cool. Like, thank you for introducing me to this record, Nick, and like forcing me to go out and listen to it. It was really interesting. It was a really beautiful record.
Acoustic guitar, but still a very full sound.
As an artist, I think he reminds me a bit of Rodriguez. And I don't know, the album is just sort of deep and reflective. Yeah, I think I'll get it more after more repeat listens. But there's some beautiful parts. There's the picking guitar on Road. That made me think of Birdsong.
So Bruce, you're familiar with Nick Drake. So perhaps it was nice to re-listen to and revisit that album.
Well, you don't know how delighted I am that you have put Nick Drake into the fore here, because Nick Drake was around I think he was actually, I think he was 70s actually, rather than 60s. I might be wrong, but he was around when I was listening to music, and I might have been one of those 5,000, I think, who went out and bought albums. Here we go. Brighter Later. So that's not Pink Moon. I do have the others on CD. That description that you read from the book is so spot on and apposite for Nick Drake. They really are stunningly, beautifully crafted songs. Very short, normally very short. What he wanted them to be as much as he could. That probably doesn't make much sense. He didn't like to work too much with other people. And the bit where you were saying that, you know, he's famous for his depression and the fact that he did eventually, you know, take an overdose and died when he was young is very true. And I think that but Pink Moon being the last album is quite interesting. As I was kind of motivated to listen through all three albums again, I found that Pink Moon, when you listen to it, is only pretty much only like a guitar and a singer. Whereas the other ones, where he had to be persuaded to by the producer to let other musicians in, I think. And for me, I think Brighter Later is a stronger album. In fact, Five Leaves Left is a beautiful album as well. And the strength of the producer there was to find the right musicians to go in. And they wrapped around his beautiful songs in the most beautiful way, with wonderful, simple instrumentation. You get onto, you get back onto your choice there, Pink Moon. I think he, at that stage, he was starting on the downhill, or, you know, was accelerating downhill. And, you know, because he didn't want to have anybody else on it, my guess is, because it is pretty much just him, still writing those wonderful, wonderful tunes.
What part of this album was that it was recorded in 2 days with just him and one sound engineer. Ah. So, yeah, definitely was isolating, or didn't want what happened in the previous, perhaps if producers were perhaps forcing his hand a little with other musicians, despite the fact it worked, he might have wanted this album to be him.
I think he was possibly losing the capability to work with other people. He was always very introspective, and the songs clearly come like that. So it was hard work for him to work with other people. It did him proud, I think, to work with other people. And towards the end, with that last one, as you say, that was kind of towards the end. And beautiful, another beautiful album. Only three albums. And as you say, only 5,000 sold. All credit to, was it Island Records? Island Records.
Yes, I believe it was.
Tend to be the best. There you go. Island Records. All credit to them for sticking with him. Because he would be, I would imagine, quite an awkward character to work with. Not like aggressively awkward, but I would imagine them having to push him a little bit. So just do this, you know, try this out, you know.
Yeah, not diva, just shy. And I think I've heard that word used to describe him in, you know, character counts. He definitely didn't like doing interviews, and eventually not even really enjoy playing live, which probably contributed to the low sale numbers.
Yeah.
Pop. What were your essential picks from Nick Drake's Pink Moon, Nick?
My first essential pick was the track Which Will. To me, it's his lyrics and the tones of the songs that really come across. And I think that this song is quite deep. I feel like it's I feel like he might be talking to like a god or to fate in this song, where he's kind of saying which will you choose, which will happen. And yeah, I picked this one just because I really thought the lyrics kind of stood out for me, and that would be interesting to get your guys' opinions on that, I guess.
All right, this is my first listen of Nick Drake's Which Will, taken from the Pink Moon album. His voice draws you in, seems to have some sort of timeless quality to it.
Good idea, except I didn't know that was your pick.
Oh. What one did you listen to, Bruce?
I like the whole album. I picked out as my standout tracks on if I got it right, were Road, Things Behind the Sun, and No. They were for me the standouts. But again, it's the kind of album where it's the whole feel of the album that works for me.
Do you want to speak on the overall feel then at all?
It's exactly what the reading that Nick did from the book.
I thought I couldn't go wrong with Nick Drake, especially in a room full of people who've got the blues. If you haven't heard him, man, it's like he boiled down all the melancholy in the world, all the bruises and all the effed up dreams you've let go, and poured those essences into a little tiny bottle and corked it up. And when he starts to play and sing, he takes the cork out and you can smell it. You're pinned into your seat as if it's a wall of noise, but it's not. It's still and it's quiet, and you don't want to breathe in case you frighten it away.
That descriptor pushed you to go out and find this record and listen to it.
Yeah. My second essential pick that I did pick was From the Morning. So it's the closing track. And I think, although I like the sound, I guess, of Which Will, I picked this one for me, the meaning of it.
Nick Drake, From the Morning. Acoustic guitar in his voice. Simple. Timeless. It sounds reflective, if that's possible.
So it's quite... I think it's the most positive song on the album. And it happens to be the last song as well, which I think is quite important. So the fact it's placed at the end is quite a melancholy album, and it comes after Harvest Breathe as well, which is perhaps one of the darker songs. And as I mentioned earlier about how people close to him say the kind of synonymous with sadness is perhaps a little bit unfair, and those who knew him that he wasn't like that all the time. The fact that he's put this song as the final song, I think, was a conscious decision. And, you know, they're talking about day after night. There's that kind of theme in it. There's a positive end to something which is negative. And there's a line in it, and now we rise and we are everywhere. And that's actually the epitaph on his headstone. And I think that's quite a beautiful line.
Isn't it just?
Yeah. With the nature of this album being a sort of quiet, beautiful and reflective sort of thing, I think for me, I'd be much better equipped to pick an essential track after a lot more repeated listens. But I would say that Horn, which is just a short instrumental acoustic piece, made me slow down. I was listening to the record, and then that one was just made me pause, made me stop for a minute.
He apparently said to his mum at one point as well that all he wanted was for his music to make one person happy. And although he, you know, perhaps didn't quite see the impact that he's had on so many people's lives, he has had. And since he created those records, how many people now have been touched by his music?
Well, I think my guess is I would probably have picked up on Nick Drake early, because I would guess it would be like John Peel would have liked Nick Drake, probably Bob Harris, two guys you would turn to for good recommendations about things that were outside of pop music. So I guess that's probably where I heard about him and really enjoyed listening to his music.
I think he must have influenced a lot of music artists. I know that Rob Smith from The Cure has definitely talked about him in interviews as well, as being a big influence on the music he did with The Cure.
The name of The Cure band comes from one of his lyrics, doesn't it?
Ah, okay.
It's from Time Has Told Me. A troubled cure for a troubled mind.
Ah, interesting fact there. I didn't know that.
Thank you for joining us on this episode of Me, My Dad and Music. If you want to hear some more stuff, you can watch one of the previous episodes of Me, My Dad and Music. If you want to hear more from Nick, you can watch our show together. It's Tomb Raider, it's Race to the End. And we've been talking about our favourite solo albums today. What's your favourite solo album and why?
Again, I've never heard it before. I don't recall ever having heard this particular artist either. It's James Iha. Not sure how to pronounce it even, because I've never heard anybody say it. I'm looking forward to hearing it, as I've enjoyed doing all the others for the first time. Let It Come Down by James Iha. Starting now. Oh, well, that's definitely worth listening to. Lovely ending as well. Good choice, bro. Thanks very much. Beautiful. Like its title.